for joining us. I'm Diane Rehm. Dame Julie Andrews is best known for her starring roles in Mary Poppins, The Sound of Music, and more recently, The Princess Diaries. Among her honors, she's won an Oscar and 2 Grammys. She's also the author of a best-selling memoir and numerous books for children. She and her daughter, Emma Walton Hamilton, have co-authored more than 20 books for young readers. Their latest is titled The Very Fairy Princess Sparkles in the Snow. Dame Julie Andrews joins me. You are welcome to be part of the program. 800-433-8850. Send us your email to drshow@wamu.org. Follow us on Facebook or send us a tweet. Well, welcome back to you, Dame Julie.
Oh, thank you so much. And hello, Diane. It's great to see you again.
And it's wonderful to see you. You are now Dame Julie.
Well, I have been most privately and happily for a while, and I don't speak about it very much. It's more something that you feel. It's so wonderful to be honored by your country.
Exactly.
And it's just a personal, private feeling inside.
Tell me what that ceremony was like.
Oh, my gosh. For me, it was one of the loveliest days because London was, it had been raining and then the sun came out and London looked like a beautiful watercolor. All the great buildings were, you know, sparkling and lovely. And then you were invited to the palace, of course, and lots of protocol and sweeping of the car before you go in and all of that. But then to walk down the halls and see the pictures, the paintings of, let's say, Queen Victoria's coronation. I mean, there they all are on the walls. It's awesome. And Her Majesty is a most gracious and friendly lady. She really is. And she's so small, and she does such an incredibly big, big job. And she's worked so
hard. She really does.
All her life, yeah.
Yes. You were at the ceremony last night at the Kennedy
Center. Yes, for my chum, the Mark Twain Prize for my chum, Carol Burnett.
What a thrill. That must have been to see her receive that.
It was.
And you spoke.
I did. I told some stories about us and how she always brings out the worst in me in a most playful way. And how whenever we're together somehow, there's a role reversal, and because she makes me so naughty, it seems as though she's Mary Poppins. But she's been a chum for 55 years.
And what kind of a chum?
One of those that is unswervingly loyal. We've had such joy in our relationship and fun, and yet we've been through the births of our children and marriage and really traumatic incidents in our lives. And yet, I wish we saw each other more often than we do because we both lead very busy
Indeed.
Lives. But when we do get together, it's as if we never stopped talking and we just pick up where we left off.
That's lovely.
Yeah.
You were here several years ago, and since then you lost your dear
My
husband.
Darling mate, yes, Blake. And it's going to be 3 years this December, and I'm still dealing with it, really, Diane. It's a hard thing. We were married 41 years and together, really, for 44, and that's a long time.
So you have a dog.
How do you know about...
I know you have a dog.
I have 2.
You have 2 dogs.
Yes.
What kind are they?
They're both poodles. One is a miniature and one is a moyenne, which is the middle size.
I see.
And they are great friends, and they make my life full of, just of joy, and they are so lively. And that's been very good for me since Blake passed.
That makes a huge difference.
It does,
I think.
Everybody always told me that. I've always, with the whole families, we've always had dogs, but these particular two, the second one I bought after Blake passed, and I thought I was buying it for the dog that was with us, and I suddenly realized I was buying it for me.
Of course.
And it was bringing life into the house and
exactly.
And taking care of a puppy again, and all of that was wonderful.
Well, you've been busy with children's theater.
I have.
Tell me about the Great American Mousicle.
It's a book that Emma and I wrote a few years ago. And it's really an homage to theater. It's about the theater, and it's about the theater in terms of mice. And it happened that several years ago, in the theater when I was performing, there was a mouse in my dressing room and in the wardrobe, and I said, "Oh, please don't kill it. Give it a humane trap and take it some." I mean, little thinking that the place was probably riddled with
them.
Yes, exactly. I took care of this particular mouse and said, "Take him out to Brooklyn somewhere." And I think my wonderful hairdresser at the time said, "Well, this little creature probably came up just to see all the stars." And a light bulb went off in my head, and I thought, "Gosh, to write a book about what the mice see." And what they do in their own world in terms of translating that into theater for mice. So it's really a band of mice that live beneath the boards of a great Broadway theater. And they perform their great shows. But they're all kind of bastardized, but they are so full of love. And it's become this enchanting musical, which has been adapted, which I directed last year at the Goodspeed, under the auspices of the Goodspeed Opera House in Connecticut. And now this year, next year, I beg your pardon, I think it's going to be doing a small tour. We've reworked it based on what we learned, and it's going to tour a little bit.
I hope it comes to Washington.
Well, it would be my dream, from your lips to someone's ears, Diane.
I hope so.
It is charming, I have to say, and the music is wonderful, and the book is funny, and you really fall in love with the characters.
You know, that was a book you wrote with your daughter,
with my
Emma.
Lovely daughter, Emma, yes, one of the many.
She is going to join us a little later in the program.
Good.
But I want to hear the story behind the very fairy princess Sparkles in the Snow.
Well, that's it's another one in the series of our Very Fairy Princess picture books for children, and it is obviously it's about this little girl who is convinced, against all evidence to the contrary, that she is a very fairy princess. Then, of course, her socks are about her ankles, but she insists always on wearing her crown and her wings and so on. And the book is about individuality and celebrating your inner sparkle and all of that. And each book in the series, this is the sixth to come out, and there's a seventh that's coming out next year, and an eighth that we've just delivered. So the series is doing so well, and it's about this wonderful little girl who sort of more than anything resembles my granddaughter, Emma's daughter. But this particular story has a kind of funny backstory, because it deals with the fact that Geraldine, or Jerry as she's called, hopes very much to sing at the school winter concert. And she's convinced that because she does try and she sings so well, that she's bound to be asked to do a solo or two. Well, in fact, they actually get a local well-known lady who is hired to do it, and she's mortified. Through a certain set of circumstances, the chance does come her way, And but she gets to the school and realizes she's just about to go on stage in her beautiful costume, and she's forgotten to bring her pretty little fairy slippers.
She's got on some boots.
So she thinks, well, what can I do? I can't go on with my snow boots on stage and sing. This story is based on something that happened to me. When I was very young, I traveled and toured a great deal, and I sang. And I said to my mother one day, Mom, I'm going to pack for myself. You don't need to do that. I'm old enough now to know better, and I'll help. So I packed my bag, and we got to the venue, and it was pouring with rain, and I was in very heavy, thick brogues and rather mud-spattered socks by the time I got in, and I suddenly realized I hadn't packed my fancy, you know, little sparkly ballet shoes. Now, my mother, with great presence of mind, said, oh, my, there was not a shop open. It was a bank holiday. There was not a dancer or anybody on the program. It was one of those rather formal concerts that I could probably borrow a pair of shoes from. But I did have my rather mud-spattered socks, which, to my chagrin, had a hole in the toe. And my mother said, well, not to worry. You did at least bring the white paint that I do the ballet shoes with to keep them clean. And she said, I'll paint a shoe on your sock.
And she did.
And so we used that story for this little book.
Marvelous story. And Julie Andrews is with me. I know many of you want to speak with her shortly after a break. And welcome back. If you've just joined us, my honored guest is Dame Julie Andrews, who, as you know, is such a huge star out of My Fair Lady, out of The Sound of Music, out of Mary Poppins. But what we have for you right now is an audition that she did at age 12. I want you to hear the sound of this voice.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in introducing to you our youngest soprano from Starlight Roof, Julie Andrews. Well, Julie, is this the first time you've ever made a gramophone record?
Oh, yes. Is it your first record, too?
No, not exactly, no. How old are you?
I am 12. How old are you?
I think I'd better ask the questions. What are you going to sing for us?
I'd like to sing the Polonaise from Nîmes.
Oh, lovely. Just the kind of junk I like.
Unbelievable, Julie.
Oh, my gosh.
Do you remember
I remember it so well. Because, of course, I did have wonderful, wonderful training by a marvelous singing teacher.
When did you begin the training? You were 12.
I was 12 when I sang that.
Yes.
Which was really my first big debut in London. But I actually started singing when I was about 7. My stepfather was a fine tenor. I don't know if I inherited the voice, because my stepfather was the one who sang. My mother was a pianist, and they were in vaudeville. And he decided to give me singing lessons to sort of keep me quiet, so to speak, because my school had been shut down due to the escalation of World War II. And I was probably horribly underfoot and hanging around the house. And so it gave me something to do. I simply hated the singing lessons with him.
Really?
But to his surprise and my mother's, there was this four and a half octave range. And as you heard, it was incredibly white and incredibly high.
Wow.
And I could do all these amazing calisthenics. So it became my stock in trade. And very quickly, he passed me on to a wonderful teacher who was my teacher for the rest of her life. And, oh my gosh, I toured and toured around England endlessly and paid my dues. And then I got fortunate enough to be asked to come to America. And then my world opened. But it was really my teacher who gave me a great technique and foundation for singing, and I'm forever grateful to her.
Now, talk to me a little bit about the commencement speech you gave at the University of Colorado at Boulder this past spring, because you spoke then about the adversity you encountered when you no longer had
that
voice. Beautiful voice.
That's right. Well, I really mostly said, I wish I could remember the speech better, but I mostly said that there will be, in spite of all the knowledge that the young students have acquired, there will be adversity, and it will hit, but that when it hits, don't just say, poor me, poor me. Lie down and get up and do something. There are so many, many, many things that you can do in the meantime while you're struggling with whatever it is you're going through. A wonderful author, T.H. White, was a friend of mine, and he wrote the most wonderful piece that Merlin taught the young King Arthur. And it was that the best thing for being sad or down, said Merlin, is to learn something, to learn about the world and why it works. And you will never, ever be bored. You will never feel sorry for yourself. It's a wonderful speech. It's huge. And so I quoted that to the students. And in truth, when I lost my voice, I was really in mourning because, you know, I'd had an operation and it hadn't gone well. I decided that I simply couldn't do nothing. I mean, I didn't want my life, my career, because my voice, I felt, was my entire identity. And to my great surprise, I learned the lesson that it actually... Of course it was, but it wasn't. And I began to start writing these little books with my daughter, Emma, and so enjoyed it. And my world, I began a second career, really. And I think I may have mentioned to you before that I was bemoaning my fate one day to my daughter when we were writing, and she said, oh, Mum, you've just found a different way of using your voice.
Exactly.
And the penny dropped, and the world was put to rights. So that's the essence of what I said that day to the students. Don't give up. Keep doing something. Nothing is wasted in life. It will all come back to you and be there for you. And this has been a great lesson for me.
What was it that led to that operation?
Oh, overwork. I mean, I had been on Broadway in Victor Victoria, and I was contracted for a year, and in fact I did it for 20 months, and you know, the early Broadway days of I was 3.5 years in My Fair Lady, and a year in Camelot, and so on, and Broadway takes its toll. There's no doubt about it. You slam vocal cords together enough times, and I think you would know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
And you develop what I now know to be striations in the chords. Not exactly nodules. I never had nodules, but occasionally my vocal cords would swell and so on. And I was asked to go on tour with Victor Victoria, and I said, I cannot, I need to rest. And then I was asked again, and I said, I cannot, I need to rest. And then I was asked again.
Huh.
And my vocal gentleman at the time said, if you do this, you will need an operation because you could get into trouble in Chicago or San Francisco and people wouldn't know your throat and what it's been through. And I foolishly agreed to the operation and regretted it hugely.
What happened during that operation?
Well, it's something I'm afraid I sort of don't wish to talk about too much. In actual fact, I ended up just missing tissue, which shouldn't have been removed.
I see.
And so the cords don't meet as they should. But it's the past, and it's the way it was. And I still have about 5 great bass notes in my voice, so I could give you a very good rendition of Old Man River if you wanted it, Diane.
But here is what you have done. Not only have you transferred your voice to your books, but you've done something else with your voice.
Some girls are fair, some are jolly and fit, some have a well-bred air or a well-honed wit. Each one's a jewel with a singular shine, a work of art with its own rare design. Dear little girl, you are terribly blessed, but it's your heart of gold I love the best, and that will be your crowning glory your whole life through. It'll always be your crowning glory, the most glorious part of you.
Now, that is what you have termed talk singing.
Talk sing. And that was not too long after the operation that I managed to pull that out. It's not what I call singing in the glorious way that I enjoyed. I don't mean that I was particularly glorious, but for me, singing is and was glorious. There's nothing more beautiful and joyous than singing with a great orchestra.
Of the human voice.
Well, yes, and you can't, you don't see it in a mirror. You just, it's a very personal thing. I do think that it's in some way, singing is like revealing one's soul. You just open up and say, well, here I am. And singing with an orchestra is beyond divine.
But now that talk singing has become even more important to you.
In a way, I don't do it very often, Diane, but I do, funnily enough, the thing I wanted to mention was that in the books that Emma and I do, we package them with as much music as we possibly can. An album, the spoken word, maybe if it's a collection of poems and rhymes, which we have 2 beautiful anthologies that we've published, and that has background music, and so children can listen to the words and enjoy the music behind it. So and then developing some of the properties that we've written for the theatre, we developed a beautiful into a beautiful piece, a little book that we wrote called Simeon's Gift, and that is symphonic, and I cannot tell you what that was like to hear it realized as a symphonic piece with narration, and we performed it several years ago now.
I wonder if you're also doing music and the book reading for the iPad.
Or yes, that's in fact being done.
Good.
Yes, some of our books are just being translated for that.
Excellent.
Because it's a whole new world. In
and
fact, I think Emma might be able to address that a little more than I, because she's a little more involved in that.
And that's a great way to get those children not only to watch and listen, but to read. And you're listening to the Diane Rehm Show. I'm going to open the phones. We've got lots of callers. 800-433-8850. First to Jean in Wellesley, Massachusetts. Hello, you're on the air.
Hi, thank you so much. Hello, Julie. Hello, Diane.
Hello.
Julie, I want to thank you so much for all the joy you've brought into my life from when I was a little girl and now I'm 57 years old.
Oh, thank you.
I've seen you a few times and I admire you for reinventing your life. I was going to ask you what the tipping point was in learning that you had a future and a life and happiness ahead of you, and you answered that about your daughter's quote. So I just want to say that do you find that you have more interaction with people now that you're writing books and doing tours, and you've opened up Julie to a whole new generation of children?
Well, thank you. Yes, I do. I love meeting people, and I always have. But now with the book signings that I do and the promotion for the books, and the greatest thrill is when someone comes up to me and says, oh, your book was the first I ever read, and it made me want to go on reading. And that is a huge, huge reward for me.
I hope that answers it. Jean, thanks for calling. Let's go to Sarah in Tamarack, Florida. You're on the air.
Hi, Julie. Oh, my gosh, this is so exciting.
Thank you.
It is, because I grew up watching you, especially in The Sound of Music. My family can tell you I know literally every single word in that musical, especially, you know, the little debate you have with Christopher Plummer. My question to you is, what was it that inspired you to sing, and how did you break into the music realm? Because I am a musician, and, you know, like, music to me is, you know, important, you know, so hearing you talk, you know, is just, you know, a big honor.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. How did I break into the music world? Well, I was very, very fortunate to be given a gift, which was that I could sing. I mean, it was discovered by my stepfather, as I was saying a little earlier, and my mother, and they were in vaudeville, and so for a long time I joined them in their act as we toured. And then eventually I went out on my own, and I did a lot of radio and very little television, because there wasn't that much around in those days. But then eventually I was performing in London and had really gone about as far as I could go. I was in a Christmas show of Cinderella at the London Palladium, and somebody came to see that show that was actually taking The Boyfriend, which was a British production, to Broadway. And they asked if I would like to be in that company and travel to America. And at first I said, no, I simply couldn't. It's too long, too far. I take care of my kids.
How old were you?
I was then 18.
Uh-huh.
And just couldn't think. And I was being asked to sign a two-year contract. And finally my dear father said, Julie, it could only last 2 months or 2 weeks. Just go and open up your head, and bless his dear heart, because I did. And, of course, it changed my life, and that production was extremely successful, which led to My Fair Lady, which led to Camelot, which led ultimately to Walt Disney. So how lucky can a young girl get?
And Tom Hanks is about to
play
Walt Disney.
Yes, Finding Mr. Banks, I think, is the title of the movie, which is coming out at Christmas, and it's about Walt Disney's search for, actually not search, it's about his tenacity and his finding P.L. Travers, who wrote Mary Poppins. He'd long wanted to buy the book.
He wasn't all that nice a person.
Disney?
As it comes out in that film. We'll take a short break, and when we come back, talk further, take your calls, stay with us.
Mm-hmm.
And welcome back, Dame Julie Andrews is with me. She is, of course, singer, actor, writer. She won an Academy Award for her starring role in Mary Poppins nearly 50 years ago.
I know, it's unbelievable.
Unbelievable. And her latest book, written with her daughter Emma, is titled The Very Fairy Princess Sparkles in the Snow. And I can attest to the fact that this book is just charming. You will love it. It's part of a best-selling children's book series co-written with her daughter Emma, who will join us in about 5 minutes. I want to talk to you a little bit about Dr. Stephen Seitel.
Oh, I'd be thrilled to talk about
him. He was profiled in a wonderful article in the New Yorker last March. He has given you great hope.
Yes, he has. Not only hope to me, but hope to
many,
thousands,
many
millions of people. He's a gentleman that is probably the foremost throat larynx surgeon and doctor in the world now. He's in Boston, and he lives, breathes, eats. really, his life is dedicated to this work, and he has pioneered so many amazing things concerning the throat. So that people who orate, I'm talking about lawyers and people of the church who have
to radio broadcasters.
Yes, and of course people with cancer and massive operations of the throat. He is able to restore voices and bring back save voices so they can still speak. And he is developing this amazing thing. We call it, quote, the stuff. Which is, the hope is that it would be injectable and able to make, let's say, a frozen vocal cord or anything like that function again. And you cannot imagine, this is micro surgery. And what you have to pioneer is something that, forgive the expression, is as soft as a baby's behind, and able at the same time to move to be resilient, to not be absorbed by the body, and also to vibrate at such a rapid speed. I mean, it's asking for a miracle, and this has to be injected, so it must go through a needle. It must not cloy or clog, or become stiff. It has to work, and I am speaking for him whenever I can. His foundation is phenomenal. I urge anybody with a really serious throat problem to go talk to him.
So that you have said, I understand, that even if something like that were to help you for as little as 6 weeks.
Well, I said to him, I think that's what helped keep him going. I said, listen, I don't care if I come back and every 6 weeks get another injection. I mean, to be able to sing again would be fabulous. Now, in all honesty, I don't fool myself. I'm older now, and it might be too late to save my vocal cords, but my God, what it will do for young singers on Broadway who, as I say, clash those vocal cords together so many, you know, 8 performances a week and develop problems, and voices should be maintained. You shouldn't keep away from a doctor. You should have maintenance while you're singing so importantly. It's very, very important that you do that.
Julie, I know you miss that beautiful 4.5-octave voice.
I do.
You miss it, but have you in your heart now been able to move on?
Oh, yeah. No, I have. I think I will always miss it, in truth. It's a little bit like my lovely spouse. I'll always miss him.
Of course.
But yes, I have a very good life. I'm very busy. I'm thrilled at the amount of music I'm still able to embrace. And by that, it's the books. I'm on the board of the Los Angeles Philharmonic. I'm a very, very proud member of the board. And I'm just swamped with glorious music, which is all part and parcel of what I love. I think I have as good as it could possibly be these days. I'm a very lucky lady.
And let's very shortly get Emma on with us. She really is your pride and joy.
Well, I have five lovely kids.
I know you do.
But this is the one that I work with in terms of the books, and it's such a joy.
Emma, are you there with us?
I am. Good morning, Diane.
Good morning.
Hello, darling.
Emma. I'm
Hi, Mom.
So glad to hear your voice.
Well, Emma, it's lovely to speak to you again.
Thank you. Emma, tell us about your role in the book and the musical, The Great American Mousicle.
Oh, well, all our books that Mom and I collaborate on together are co-written in a very sort of organic process. I wish I could describe properly, but it really is very, very collaborative. And so we co-authored the book, although the original idea, of course, was inspired by this little story about a mouse in the theater where Mom was working. I, when we wrote the book, at the time was running my own small regional theater out here in Sag Harbor where I live, and my background was in theater, and there were plenty of mice and other human
as there are in most theaters.
I'll bet.
Yeah, so so all the characters in the book are characters we know and love from our own shared life in the theater, and I wish I could say I'd had a more active role in the musical, in the actual creation of the musical. I was very involved in the collaborative process leading up to production, in terms of developing the script and the songs with our wonderful co-collaborators Hunter Bell and Marcy Heisler and Zena Goldrich, who wrote the music and lyrics.
And they are good.
And they
I have
are
to
superb.
Say they are
yeah.
good.
But the show being produced at Goodspeed, which is in Connecticut, was in another state, and my day job and my family commitments here didn't allow me to be a part of the actual rehearsal process. So
well,
it's a great thrill to be there on opening night and
yeah.
be a member of the audience.
And what I've said is that I'm really hoping that that will come to Washington. It would just be a great treat for all
from
of
From your
us.
Lips to whomever the powers that be in Washington's ears, Diane.
I think they are listening. Here is an email, Julie, from Larry in North Dallas, who says there is a scene in Thoroughly Modern Millie where Julie sings at a Jewish wedding. And Larry says, I want to compliment and thank her for her impeccable Yiddish. How did you manage
I
to
had
do
somebody
that?
Help me.
You had someone
yes,
to help
Yes, of course.
You.
I mean, you know, this incredibly sort of British lady, white bread English lady, as they say. And I really had no idea how to go about it. And the wonderful lady came and coached me, let's say.
Emma, did you ever hear your mother sing in Yiddish?
Oh, sure. Well, not before that moment.
No.
many times since.
Yes.
That's wonderful. Emma, I know you wrote a book titled Raising Bookworms. Tell us how you help children develop a love of reading.
Mm.
Oh, thank you, Diane. Yes. Well, I wrote the book really for two reasons. One, because it was in response, in an attempt to answer the question that my mom and I were continually hearing when we went on speaking engagements and book signings together, and that was, how do I get my child to put down the electronics and pick up a book?
Exactly.
And also because, of course, I'm a mom, and I had the same questions myself in my home. So I did write that book as a real exploration of the answers to that question, and of course, also in my professional life, I spend a lot of time attempting to answer that question by most of my work outside of what I do with Mom, is in relationship to Stony Brook Southampton, which is the satellite campus of Stony Brook University. And I work for the MFA in Creative Writing and Literature there. I teach children's literature, and I run a children's literature fellows program for people who want to write children's books. But I also work in an outreach with high school and middle school students in our area and in New York City, bringing fiction, poetry, essay, playwriting, screenwriting workshops into the
Wonderful.
School.
Wonderful. And I was asking your mother earlier about bringing your books to the electronic platform.
Yes.
Onto iPads and iPods.
Mm-hmm.
What's happening there?
Well, that's very much in process, and of course, is very much the wave of the future in terms of the publishing industry. And many people, you know, argue, is this reading if we allow our kids to read on electronic devices and so forth? But I'm a big advocate for it. My son has an eye issue that makes it challenging for him to read, and audiobooks provide a great solution for him. So audiobooks, e-books, I'm a big fan of all of those. And we're just actually working right now with, of course, our publisher, Little Brown, has been great in terms of developing audiobooks and apps for all of our books, including the Very Fairy Princess series. And we're also working with a company called Weston Woods to make a short film of the Very Fairy Princess that will go out into schools and libraries.
All right. And
in fact, we're discussing the franchise being developed for either a small series on television and things like that. There's a lot happening with all the books here.
Wonderful. Julie, I asked you earlier about your commencement speech in Colorado. You talked to the students about fear. And I'm wondering, at this stage in your life, what makes you fearful?
Oh, heavens. Gosh. I think
fireworks.
Emma, thank you.
Fireworks.
Fireworks, yes.
And balloons.
And balloons. Anything that explodes without my being able to have any
control
of it. Exactly. It's a control issue. But I something about my ears being super sensitive, I don't know. But fireworks, I usually go and hide in the bathroom or something. But no, real fear, I think it's always present in all of us. And what did I say to them about fear? Oh, I turned my fear of audiences and, you know, was I going to be good enough and all of that stupidity. Uh-huh. I turned it into the pleasure of giving. And once I discovered that, a great deal of the fear went away.
And you're listening to the Diane Rehm Show. I'm going to quote what you told that audience.
Oh, thank you, my dear.
You said fear is just part of life.
It is.
The trick is to recognize it and press on anyway.
Mm-hmm.
The real trick, however, is to stop focusing
inwardly
on yourselves and start focusing on others.
Yeah, in the giving, yeah. And that made all the difference for me. It was something that took me years to learn, you know. But it's true. I found it for myself, and I highly recommend it.
We cannot let this hour pass without one of everybody's favorite musical from Julie Andrews.
It is a game, isn't it, Mary Poppins?
Well, it depends on your point of view.
You know,
you see, in every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun, and snap, the job's a game. And every task you undertake becomes a piece of cake, a lark, a spree. It's very clear to see that a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, the medicine go down, medicine go down. Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down in a most delightful way. A robin feathering his nest has very little time to rest while gathering his bits of twine and twig. Though quite intent in his pursuit, he has a merry tune to toot. He knows a song will move the job along.
And you might just talk about that film coming out about the author P.L. Travers.
Well, I met her. She was quite a character. She was a tough, tough lady. And when I'd just given birth to Emma, she literally called me the day after I gave birth and said, "This is P.L. Travers." And I said, "Oh, hello, Miss Travers." I'd never met her. And she said, "I understand you're going to be playing the part of Mary Poppins." And I said, "Yes." She said, "Well, talk to me." And I said, "Well, what can I say? I'm feeling a little exhausted right now. I just gave birth to my lovely daughter." And she said, "Well," she said, "you're far too pretty for it, of course, but you've got the nose for it." And then the movie is about Disney and how he wooed her for something like 20 years. Actually, he was the honey bun. She was the toughie.
Really?
Yes, indeed. And I can attest to that.
And what about the Banks family itself?
Well, the Banks, actually, what the movie is about mostly is, as I say, Disney's wooing of Pamela Travers. But actually, the basis of the film is all about her background and what led to her, what influences led to her writing Mary Poppins. And it's a very interesting story.
I'll look forward to seeing it. Most of all, I'm looking forward to reading your next book, seeing you again, the book, The Very Fairy Princess Sparkles in the Snow, by Julie Andrews and Emma Walton Hamilton. What a joy to see you.
Oh, you too, Diane. And Emma, I'll see you soon, darling.
Love you, Mom.
Love you.
Thank you so much, and thanks all for listening. I'm Diane Rehm.